Then we get caught in a roadblock and tell the Mr. Police that I ain't got no bird surfer ticket right here.
Thank you very much again for coming. Okay, the background to this is, I think you will have to get the book, but what I'll give you is to give you a sense of how I put things down, the imagery, et cetera, et cetera. It's a consistent narrative of what is occurring at the time of 19th century, but most of the book is set in post-1960. So it gives that kind of background. I think I had a little desire to show part of the history also. Guban means burnt, and it's actually a metaphor. It's an area, volcanic area in the northeast of Somalia that the nomads call the mountains that it rains because of its color. It's volcanic, burnt. I use it as a metaphor for the nation state and its people. Okay, first of all, I would like to get it to Harlem, you know, and then maybe possibly think about Isli is a neighborhood in Nairobi, Kenya, where it's, you know, pretty much predominantly, probably about 500,000 Somalis live there. So the reaction will, I guess, at some point or the other show up. But at the moment, I'm actually struggling to get it to my people right here. Elk City.
He gets arrested.
Yeah, yeah. He gets arrested right away.
Early on.
Yeah, very early on. Hue-Man is a businessman, and Hue-Man actually, for those who speak Somali, it means one who really works hard and in a very righteous way. He works with his brawn to get his stuff. And so the symbolism of the character is that this is basically a business person who's doing what he can, making that penny count for another penny, et cetera, et cetera. What I would say about the book is that it has many registers. If you necessarily want to remove the setting and look at the people who are humans in it, then you will find a commonality in for example, calumny, greed, treachery, ambition. You know, the introduction and the beginnings of it is that the person will, what they will see or what they will encounter. Of course, I cannot read my own book. I've try as I might, but what you can get from it is that it gives you a multiplicity of things. It gives you the perspective of the water bearer. It gives you the perspective of the elite. It gives you the perspective of the village chief. It gives you all those interactions in many formations. And it also moves from a tiny encampment all the way to superpower machinations. So it is an atomized, panoptic vision of a place, but looking at it from a worldly perspective and how one fits in or out of that. So eventually, I think, you know, one can conceive that the village chief can be Obama with the face, you know, with the things that they're faced with, to some extent. And so that would be the introduction, and then people will be faced with, okay, well, the imagery of the warlord, this and this and this, and that's what they will come to the table. They will see probably this woman, and then, you know, engage the book, and we'll see what happens after that. But the whole point is, I think, for a writer or anyone who's doing anything, is to actually inhabit a space where it's uninhabitable because nothing of yours is ever heard. Every narrative or every grand narrative, everything that is spoken about is really done on your behalf. So, you know, this is just a one person trying to say, okay, well, you were writing so much about the horn, about Somalia, about dehumanizing people, but it really fits into the classic you know, racial things that, you know, stereotypes and things like that, that that they're often depicted without thought, you know, and this is the predisposition. So this just adds, you know, and tries to counter all of those years of organization.
The whole idea is like when I was writing, I was thinking, you know, this guy would put off his basketball game and or whatever it is he's watching, put away his beer and actually read this book. So, you know, I'm still hoping for that to happen. So there you have it. Thank you for coming out.
Yeah.